Hello, my name is Josh Vigilo, and I'm the Director of Operations at Truth Exchange. Welcome to our second online symposium, Stolen Identity, the Theft of the Binary. A couple of housekeeping notes before we begin. If you're enjoying the content so far of this symposium, be sure to give us a thumbs up or subscribe if you haven't already done so. That allows us to stay in touch with you and keep you updated with more free resources from Truth Exchange. You can also visit us online at www.truthexchange.com. We have two lectures today, The Rising Global Spirituality, The Search for Personhood by Carl Teichrib, and the second, which is by Pamela Frost, Stolen Identity, The Enneagram. Carl Teichrib is a Canadian-based researcher and writer. He's a friend of Truth Exchange and has been speaking at a number of our events over the years. He writes for Forcing Change and has a few books out available on Amazon.com. On behalf of the Truth Exchange board and staff, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, Dr. Peter Jones and the staff at Truth Exchange for hosting this important symposium. I'm excited to be sharing on a vital topic, the rising global spirituality and the search for personal identity. Before I dive into the subject, allow me to briefly offer some background and an explanation of my work, for this will help you to better understand the approach and the evidence that will be presented. Since the early 1990s and full-time since 1997, I've been documenting and analyzing how the Western world is shifting, moving away from a Judeo-Christian understanding to the acceptance of an Earth-centric view, what we would rightly call a form of planetary paganism. From 1997 until 2001, I was the director of research for a small Christian-based information and publishing organization that focused on challenging the New Age movement and documenting and challenging its political and cultural influences. I have since freelanced in this field, providing research and input to other Christian authors and groups. And for 9 years, I managed an online monthly publication titled Forcing Change, outlining present forces of change, religious, political, technological, and cultural forces of change. I teach a modular course at Miller College of the Bible on secular and pagan trends, and I'm the author of this book, Game of Gods, The Temple of Man in the Age of Reenchantment. My research work includes literature studies, data collection, and, when possible, and this is important, direct observation. A handful of primary topics are explored, often with overlapping themes, each merging at the crossroads of civilization, where we are to stand with the gospel of Jesus Christ. The four main categories that I focus on are global governance, from ideas of collective security to UN empowerment. Way back in the day, I frequently attended World Federalist events and other gatherings aimed at elevating global political agendas and processes. Even though we won't examine this topic, I'll still give you a bit of a spoiler. The core takeaway of global governance is that it's an alternative salvation claim. That is, through our international political action, we build the kingdom of heaven on earth, with collective humanity being both the redeemer and the recipient. Technology, and more specifically transhumanism, as a philosophical and religious and spiritual application. Along the way, I've had the opportunity to attend a number of transhumanist events, both in person and within existing metaverse platforms. Religion, particularly interfaithism, which is a form of global spiritual politics. And we'll be taking a little look at that today. However, other religious influences, such as Eastern forms of spirituality and witchcraft, have been points of my study. And then finally, the cultural aspects of oneism. Evolutionary culture, including transformational gatherings like Burning Man and associated movements such as visionary art, the importance of psychedelics as a driver of macro-spiritual change, how culture is embracing and then projecting the experience of oneness. So those are my primary areas of research, and some of this will bleed over into this presentation as we examine the shift towards a global spiritual paradigm and the place of man within it. As Christians, this broad spiritual transformation must be understood through a biblical perspective, recognizing that what is being challenged is nothing less than the scriptural foundation of reality, the unique position of God, the fallen state of humanity, and the necessity of salvation through Jesus Christ alone. In other words, what is being projected by the world is a claim opposite of that biblical framework. God is not unique. All things are divine. Therefore, man is not fallen, but humanity does face moral problems and crises. Hence, if salvation is to be attained and the kingdom of God established on earth, it can only come through our endeavors, through the works of our collective hands. And that sets the tone. Indeed, it's an outgrowth of two key events in the book of Genesis. The fall of man with its promise of nature divinity, that you, the creation, will be as or like God, which is an act of divine identity theft, claiming an exalted position that is not ours to claim. And then our collective action, as foreshadowed in the Babel story, in joining to build our tower, our cosmopolis, our world city with its unifying purpose, we proclaim our own order. It is creation elevating itself, exchanging the truth for the lie, and with it a false promise that as we transgress God's order, we transform into the divine. However, the transcendent God, the one who is outside of creation, time, matter, and space, the one who reveals himself, reveals that we are not divine, that the artistry, as amazing as creation is, nevertheless cannot be the same as the artist. Isaiah 46, verses 5 to 11. To whom will you liken me and make me equal and compare me, that we should be alike? They lavish gold out of the bag and weigh silver on the scales. They hire a goldsmith and he makes it a god. They prostrate themselves. Yes, they worship. They bear it on the shoulder, they carry it and set it in its place, and it stands. From its place it shall not move. Though one cries out to it, yet it cannot answer, nor save him out of his trouble. Remember this, and show yourselves, men. Recall to mind, O you transgressors. Remember the former things of old, for I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. Calling a bird of prey from the east, the man who executes my counsel from a far country, indeed, I have spoken it. I will also bring it to pass. I have purposed it. I will also do it. Isaiah 44, verses 6 and 8. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and the Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first, and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. Is there a God besides me? Indeed, there is no other rock. I know not one. And then out of 1 Chronicles 29. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power and the glory, the victory and the majesty. For all that is in the heaven and in earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head over all. Both riches and honor come from you, and you reign over all. In your hand is power and might. In your hand it is to make great and to give strength to all. Now, therefore, our God, we thank you and praise your glorious name. And then the one who is exalted exalted by his own stature, the Lord of heaven and earth is revealed through Jesus Christ. Colossians 1:16-18. For by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he may have the preeminence. Yes, indeed, our Lord is the Creator. He is distinct from creation. His deeds are worthy of praise and proclamation. And because he is the Creator, he is the one to be feared. He is above all things, material and spiritual, having created all things. He has the power and the glory, and his is the kingdom. But, we refuse to acknowledge God's position. We cannot fathom a God whose existence is not tied to natural processes. Nature is divine. We can't comprehend a God whose separateness, his holiness, levels out humanity before him. Kings, popes, princes, paupers, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Therefore, we bend our knees to what is created, and we choose our own spirituality. And this is both a personal journey, the search for self-spirituality, and this is important, and a communal effort, a planetary re-enchantment. My first taste of this as a researcher happened back in 1997 in Vancouver, British Columbia, at the Global Citizenship 2000 Youth Congress, which had as its guest speaker, its plenary speaker, Robert Mueller, the Prophet of Hope from the United Nations. We received a symbolic Earth passport, and in its cover it said this: "You are the Earth becoming conscious of herself. Unite, global citizens, to save and heal planet Earth." Now, what's important is the understanding of who the audience at this conference is or was. It was mostly made up of school children, educators, those involved in developing curriculums. Robert Mueller explained to the children who are present, "You are not children of Canada. You are really living units of the cosmos, because the Earth is a cosmic phenomena. We are all cosmic units. This is why religions tell you, you are divine. We are divine energy. It is in your hands whether revolution on this planet continues or not." And he went on to say that what we needed to do as children, as educators, as citizens of the world, we need to tremendously strengthen the United Nations, or we need to establish a world federation, or we need to develop regional continental units, and then unite these units, we will form or create a world union. As he explained to the audience, you can be caretakers and the saviors of the world. Everybody, remember your Mother Earth. His role at this event was to inspire. And so he told all of us in attendance that if we could just come up with a fantastic idea, we could have a fantastic future. And so some of the schools that were represented came up with various ideas. Some said that they would be starting school-based interfaith groups and global citizenship clubs. One school suggested that we needed to foster Earth pride and form celebrations around planetary identity. One school said, and now keep in mind, these are, and in this particular case, this was an elementary school. This is from the mouth of children. "We need to zero world debt, replace money with biometric cards and Earth points." And in all this, we were told that what we had to do was instill global spiritual and ethical values. And this was the role of public education. During part of the weekend, one group that I was sitting with made a comment. And it was, well, it was precise. One of the participants said, "Make it a virus," speaking of this worldview. "Make it a virus. No inoculation. Infect everyone." At the end of the conference, we were all treated to Ganesha. Students gathered around and we watched a theatrical troupe bring Ganesha forward. And Ganesha explained to the children, "I've been around for thousands and thousands of years, and you can call on me anytime to remove your thoughts of any obstacles. If you should ever worry or anguish, or if life gets you down, whisper an om. Call on loving Ganesha, who is always there, for Ganesha is none other than you. Oneness, that creation is divine, you are divine, was the spiritual foundation, the bedrock for both personal and planetary transformation. And this would be personally experienced as your higher self emerged. And this would be experienced in the aggregate as the planetary community would birth itself. In our unity, we would be born again." What was taking place at the Global Citizenship Congress was the living out of what one of the organizers described in his book, The Visioneers. Desmond Berghofer wrote this: "The supreme motivating concept of the future is synergy. Men and women of all nations coming together under leaders of great vision, who see that the pursuit of a common ideal, one world, one earth, one people, is the reason for all existence." We're also living out what Robert Mueller described in his book, New Genesis. This was being experienced by those students who were told that they were indeed divine. Humankind is seeking no less than its reunion with the divine, its transcendence into ever higher forms of life. Hindus call our earth Brahma, or God, for they rightly see no difference between our earth and the divine. This ancient, simple truth is slowly dawning upon humanity. Its full flowering will be the real, great, new story of humanity as we are about to enter our cosmic age and to become what we were always meant to be, the planet of God. Interestingly, two evenings before I sat down to record this presentation, I was at a social function where I had a wonderful discussion with a young man. The primary thrust of our conversation was around the question of religion and ultimate meaning. I explained the difference between the oneist worldview and twoism, and not surprisingly, he openly landed on the oneist perspective. As he explained it, the universe is God. The universe is therefore spiritual. We are all connected. I am the universe. The universe is divine? I am the universe? How did we arrive here? What's going on? Maybe a very brief overview of Western thought will shed some light on this. Now, if you're a student in my secular trends class, you would need to know this chart. Yes, it's rather simplistic, and the argumentation, which is certainly more in depth, is outlined in my book. But in this one chart, we see the shift of epochs of thought, a broad overview of how Western intellectualism and given cultural norms have shifted. Historically, we see the changeover from primitive paganism, the Greco-Roman system, to Christendom. That era, Christendom, for better or for worse, saw the church and state intertwined. Culturally, a Christian thread ran throughout society. It offered a religious, social, and relational foundation. Even if you weren't a professing Christian, the larger influence was nevertheless there. And then with the Enlightenment, we moved into modernity, the elevation of rationalism, naturalism, positivism. Materialism and science ruled the day, church and state separated. But in 1914, modernity entered the age of industrial killing as the Great War ravaged Europe. 2 decades later, the atomic mushroom cloud signaled the height or the depth of modernity. And then came Vietnam, with France wrecking itself at Dien Bien Phu, and then the American experience, and Nixon, and Watergate, and the loss of trust. Modernity had stripped the soul. It had brought us to the brink. And so postmodernism enters, questioning authority and power structures. It screamed out great social questions, but ultimately it couldn't offer answers. And so the seeds of its own demise, or transformation, was sown at the same time, for a vacuum of meaning demands to be filled. The search begins for a new framework, a new story, a new myth, one pulled from the ancient past, recast and reframed, and then sold to us as the basis of meaning and purpose. And so we enter the age of reenchantment, the era of oneness. Now, some people might say, hey, reenchantment and the New Age movement, are they basically the same? They are definitely related, yet there is a difference, and it's an important difference. First, the New Age tended to focus on the self, self-realization, self-actualization, the awakening of your divine self. In fact, the New Age movement, in many respects, was the personalization of reenchantment. But reenchantment is more broad or more contextually deep than the New Age, which was considered to be more like a consumerist spirituality. Reenchantment, however, focused on we, the community of all. Our meaning is found in the universal. The I is integrated in a collective, in the cosmic relationship with nature and supernatural. We are one in our essence. The self finds meaning within a unifying wholeness. And we ground ourselves in a spiritual, material communion. It is a social, communal sense of wonder and magic, this feeling of our oneness. Reenchantment is the development of an ancient future mythos. And when I speak of myth, I'm not talking about a tale or a fable, but rather a reality claim wrapped in a grand vision or story. It is a type of worldview information technology that enables culture to shift from one religion to what is essentially another religion. It offers a robust setting for change. It transforms through a new guiding story. It embraces a sacred contract with natural processes, what is essentially a pagan veneration of nature, the return of Gaia. This nature connection gives back to us a sense of wonder and belonging, and this gives us a sense of purpose. It enables a feeling of being part of something grander, even mysterious. It has a cosmic spiritual quality, a sense that we are experiencing an unfolding connection between ourselves and the universe. And so it compels us to rethink and then alter our beliefs, values, and this is very important, our behaviors, as we anticipate becoming a new humanity in a holistic tomorrow. And so reenchantment offers an eschatology. It's a total system change that will inevitably produce heaven on earth. Therefore, our politics, religion, culture, and even technology must refocus. Reenchantment, as an outgrowth of the postmodern experience, for in many ways it is the rediscovery of meaning from out of the postmodern vacuum, demands that our personal values are formed by the crowd. It is a feelings-based, experiential sense of reality, authenticated by the emotional energy of the group. And so we reinforce our folly by emulating each other and calling this truth. So purpose is found in the collective. Salvation is achieved by group effort. Let's call it sacred secularism or mystical materialism. This sense that creation is divine. God does not exist outside of nature. So we direct evolution. We awaken the cosmos. Listen, the global spiritual paradigm, this myth of oneness, is personally affirmed by your feelings. That is the inner confirmation of the oneness myth. Now, Edgar Mitchell, the astronaut, touched on this when he explained the personal impact of space travel. The experience in space was so powerful, I started digging into various literatures to try to understand what had happened. I found nothing in science literature, but eventually discovered it in the Sanskrit of ancient India. The descriptions of samadhi were exactly what I felt. It is described as seeing things in their separateness, but experiencing them viscerally as a unity, as oneness accompanied by ecstasy. He went on, I realize that the story of ourselves as told by science, our cosmology, our religion, was incomplete and likely flawed. I recognize that the Newtonian idea of separate, independent, discrete things in the universe wasn't a fully accurate description. What was needed was a new story of who we are and what we are capable of becoming. Indeed, the visionary thinkers of the 1960s and 70s openly talked of the necessity of a new framing story. The Club of Rome offered one example. Western developed countries are among the best initial candidates for the myth-making project. The countries of this area will be required to make some significant and sometimes drastic shifts of perception in order for the new international order to be fulfilled. Thus, it is very important for these societies to make changes in their value systems. In addition, a shift in values in these societies should have a great impact on the rest of the world. The Western countries, therefore, appear to be very good candidates for the reception of myths about a global society. The Stanford Research Institute's Changing Images of Man program also wrestled with what a new vision would entail. The new myth would be built on an ecological ethic, the total community of life in nature, holism, a oneness of existence. It was also a self-realization ethic, the power of human potential, and the self would become integrated into the wider collective. It was multi-leveled, multifaceted, and integrative. It would embrace diversity as transformative by finding synthesis. Thus, it would recast our old values, offering an improved new image that is sophisticated, progressive. It would be experiential, experimental, open-ended, evolutionary. And then the Esalon Institute. The Esalon Institute played with re-enchantment. It helped frame it and fashion it and brought it into society. Now, the Esalen Institute was founded in 1962 with the inspiration of Aldous Huxley. It was and still remains a place of convergence on the California coast, a liminal space where personal change could be a lived experience, and then that change would flow back into the default world and impact the larger social fabric. It was a container to explore human potential, and it still is that kind of a container where you can now play with spiritual democracy and integrate Eastern practices, psychedelics, and psychology, along with the perennial philosophy, and discover your wholeness, your oneness. Esalon hosts hundreds of workshops each year on transformational subjects. It's an experiential playground for social change agents, progressive academia, maverick theologians, visionary artists, leading psychologists, spiritual explorers, diplomats, and global insiders would come. It was really the professional engine of the counterculture. It was the springboard for the new age and the coming of re-enchantment. Two workshops are worthy of mention because both demonstrate the concept of re-enchantment, this complete integrative approach. From 1993, the Esalon Catalog. Is information immortal? What unexplored realms of spirit will we encounter with amazing new forms of computer and electronic hypermedia? New myths will be needed. New mysteries will be encountered. How can ancient models of mind, such as shamanism, Hinduism, or voodoo, help us comprehend silicon-based consciousness? Why are neuroenhancers crucial tools for so many computer innovators? Can humans share an erotic relationship with a machine being? Are earth spirits at play in fields of photons and electronic spin? A neo-psychedelic subculture is co-evolving with new technologies to reveal glimpses of exotic futures. And then from the 1996 catalog. To wholeheartedly embrace technology may be the only way to partake in the next phase of human evolution. Participants will experience brain machines, the internet, computer fractals, virtual reality, tarot, astrology, and I Ching through computer programs, chaos math, hemispheric alignment, audio, video games, and even new media. The workshop will explore the techno-vision quest and evaluate it as an adjunct to more traditional spiritual practices. The weekend will conclude with a techno-pagan rave dance. Participants are encouraged to bring at least one item of technology. Now, we kind of laugh at that. One item of technology. Now we have multiple items of technology, and we all can connect. We can all participate in the metaverse, the technology of oneness. Irvin Laszlo, one of the early architects of the Global Mythmaking Program, who helped coordinate the Club of Rome's Global Community Program and influenced the SRI Changing Images of Man report, put it this way in 2005. Why do I think this re-enchantment of the cosmos is important? Because oneness, wholeness, has been around for thousands of years. A sense of oneness can be recovered. So in my remaining minutes, I'd like to offer a couple of tastes, two tastes specifically, regarding how this global spirituality manifests. The first is the Parliament of the World Religions, because it fits this dynamic. I've attended three parliaments, including last year's virtual gathering, and I can tell you that the parliament is a hub that reinforces global spirituality and places this, the concept of interfaithism, within the identity of yourself as a global citizen. So here are a few images from the 2015 event, which brought to the table approximately 10,000 religious leaders and spiritual teachers. The first set of pictures is the opening of the parliament itself. It was an energized ceremony as participants anticipated a week of transformation, and it was kicked off with a procession of shamans. The second set is from the hallway of the goddess. One of the main corridors was established as a place to honor the divine feminine, with dozens and dozens and dozens of banners depicting the goddess in her historical forms. Repeatedly, we were told during the week that we, too, are Mother Earth walking. We are divine priestesses, that we work to protect, honor, and serve the Mother Goddess. And this, indeed, is our act of service to the sacredness of the Earth. We are all spiritually connected to her energy, and our identity and responsibility is wrapped in her global cause. And at both the 2015 and 2018 parliaments, we had a red tent temple. It was considered the womb of the parliament, a place to honor the sacred flow. Here, you could attend workshops and rituals to help you reconnect to the divine feminine spirituality of the universe. One of the many workshops I attended in 2015 was dedicated to the question, are we really all one? The room was full. We had representatives from Christianity, Buddhism, Wicca, Hinduism, Islam, and other faiths. The session started with participants entering a state of guided meditation, intentionally going into that sacred space through breath work and quieting the mind. Then Philip Goldberg, an author on Eastern spirituality, asked everyone in the room to shout out a word that reflected your religious aha moment, that critical point in your spiritual walk when you got it. So people shouted out joy, peace, transcendence, acceptance, love, unity, harmony, oneness. See, we were told, you're all saying the same thing. No matter your religious background, you are all experiencing the same spirituality. Each of you are connecting into that mystical flow. It doesn't matter what your doctrine is. It's what you experience. Philip then told us, I am you. You are me. It is that level of unification and oneness that we wanted to address this morning because we thought it is the most fundamental level of unity. The most fundamental level of oneness, and it's not to be found in reasoning or in dialogue. It's to be found in the direct experience of that reality within ourselves, to see the divinity in other people. That is a wonderful thing. It is on the level of direct experience where you perceive the divinity in ourselves and in other people, and not just to think about it. That true oneness is to be found. And this is not just an intellectual construct, but there's practical reality. But there's practical reality because it's in transcending that usual source of identity and identification that we awaken to the divinity within ourselves. That spiritual transformation takes place, and transformational consciousness takes place, and the opening of the human heart takes place. So that acting from compassion and acting from care and concern for the others and the planet does not have to be an effort, because we see the divinity in all things. Jumping to the 2018 Parliament in Toronto, its theme was the promise of inclusion, the power of love. But it had no room for exclusive religious claims. Oneness must end separating faiths. Implied and sometimes not very far below the surface, in fact, it even poked up past the surface, was that the uniqueness of Jesus Christ is divisive. And that is true. The exclusive claim of Jesus Christ is one that separates. But from the interfaith perspective, from that point of global spirituality, this is a negative claim that must be overcome. Nationalism, we were told repeatedly, is the greatest threat, an evil scourge. And free market capitalism, grossly immoral. Repeatedly, religious supremacy was connected to national supremacy. And we have a problem of Christian nationalism, which is really, we were told, white supremacy. Jim Wallace of Sojourners reminded us, now keep in mind, this is the fall of 2018, that America was in the midst of the midterm elections, and that this was going to be a battle between angels and demons. The Republicans having sided with demons, and evangelicals specifically, well, they have betrayed Jesus for political power. One art piece is especially noteworthy. Remember the theme, the promise of inclusivity, the power of love. Here we have a Baptist minister using the Buddhist tradition of making a sand mandala to reflect the Hindu deity Kali. And there, in the sand, Kali was holding the severed head of Supreme Court Justice Kavanaugh, and around Kali's belt were the severed heads of those who confirmed him. Then, at the end of the week, and I was there to witness this, I videotaped it. Participants engaged in a dance song invocation to Kali to bring destructive justice to Kavanaugh. It was pretty telling. The promise of inclusivity, the power of love. At the end of the 2018 Parliament, Larry Greenfield, the executive director, thanked all of us for engaging in the salvation of the Earth. Because as we save the Earth, we are part of this cosmic story. We're saving ourselves. And so he repeated that theme, saying, thanks to all of those who are committed to the salvation of the earth. But of all the examples of what this new global spirituality looks like, and expressions of personal identity that forms an association with this myth of oneness, probably the most intensive is to be found within evolutionary culture, especially the realm of transformational gatherings, transformational festivals. Now, this is a topic that demands a deeper explanation than what I can give here, both in its contemporary context and its historical development. And if you want to know more, and I would encourage you to do so, read chapter 14 in my book, as it is solely dedicated to this movement. So allow me, for a very short time, and certainly without the justice it deserves, to take you into the world of evolutionary culture, transformational community. For it is here, in this festive space, where you personally immerse yourself in the group feeling, where you can be re-enchanted with the magic of this energy, and your identity shifts with the experience. Transformational festivals offer a place where modern forces of change merge with ancient forces of spirit. It is a foreshadowing, a chance to live in what tomorrow might be. Now, we're just going to scratch the surface, and then we're going to jump into one of the better known and probably the most important examples, and that is Burning Man. But when we consider this as a movement, it's important to note that commonalities exist from event to event. Certainly each gathering is unique, but there are some often overlapping qualities. So, transformational encounters. The first thing is, it's about communitas. It's an organic feeling of oneness and community. It's this power of a shared, experiential, ecstatic group encounter, communitas, this oneness and community. Transformational encounters often have sacred spaces, temples, shrines. It becomes a spiritual experience. You will encounter yoga, energy healing, shamanism, plant medicine, psychedelics. You can go to workshops, go to group discussions, networking events. There are full curriculums that you can immerse yourself in on a variety of topics. Everything from horticulture to cryptocurrency to painting and artwork. Music forms a very important component to this experience. It becomes a driver for communitas, especially EDM and trance music, but other music forms are there too. Music is just simply the vehicle. Visionary and interactive art becomes vehicles of illumination at these events. There's a feeling, and certainly a motto or a mantra of oneness with nature, a sense of harmony, harmony with the natural world, a sense of connection with creation. It is radically tolerant, non-judgmental. It is often, depending on the event, clothing optional. It's a journey, a quest, an anticipation of transformation. It's shedding your limitations. It's about shedding and transgressing the norms. And in doing this, you engage in transformation, first personally, and then you allow it to seep into the cracks and pores of civilization, and society transforms with you. Back in 2015, ironically, while traveling to the Truth Exchange Symposium to talk about evolutionary culture, I had the opportunity to sit beside a transformational artist while waiting for a connecting flight in Minneapolis. And oftentimes there's a wearable, observable identity with this community. And so I struck up a conversation because it was obvious that she was a flow artist and that she was part of this movement just by the garb she was wearing. So she, in turn, listed off a number of gatherings that she'd attended. And in fact, she was on her way to California to attend one. So I asked her, what is the commonality? She replied without missing a beat, oh, it's spiritual. It's all very spiritual. Now, this is something that event influencer G.K. Leung recognized back in his 2010 TEDx talk on transformational festivals. This is what he said. No less profound is this emergence of a new type of spiritual culture in these festivals, a spiritual culture completely uninterested in charismatic leaders, dogmas, or doctrine, where ritual does not require that we surrender our autonomy as critical thinking individuals, but instead arises as the shared acknowledgement and honoring of our sacred experience together. One event organizer put it this way, that's what established religions have done. It said, God is separate. God is other. God is outside of you. And this is what I think has been the great fall from grace, is humanity disconnecting from the experience of spirituality. Part of what we're doing at these gatherings is regaining our natural, intuitive wisdom and redeveloping this deep experience of the divine. Although I've been studying worldview issues for a number of years, it wasn't until 2008 that things started to click for me regarding this movement. I guess I'm a late learner sometimes. Yes, I had heard about Burning Man around the year 2000, but I hadn't put it together that this was part of a global phenomena, a global movement, a global spiritual experience. So in 2008, I started to take this subject more seriously and began to research the culture. But it took until 2015. It was after the Truth Exchange Symposium, a number of months afterwards, before I attended my first transformational event. It was a small festival called Dimensional Rift with a theme, Together We Are One. And I attended with the specific purpose of doing worldview surveys. This is what I discovered, that on my questionnaire, when I asked them to identify their past and present religions, half identified as past Christian, but now consider themselves to be either Buddhist or New Age or Wiccan or transhuman or agnostic or atheist. To the statement, God is separate from nature and me, all of those who religiously identified disagreed with that statement. God, nature, and humanity, therefore, are one. To the statement, humanity is valued above nature, most disagreed. To the statement, Earth is a living organism, the majority agreed with that. I went to Pinoca, Alberta, to attend a regional Burning Man known as Freezer Burn back in 2017, and I conducted surveys of about 10% of the population, so I had roughly, I think, 85 or 90 surveys done over the course of the 3-day event. And again, past religion, Christian. Past religion, Christian. What was your past religion? What did you identify as in terms of your religious experience in the past? Christian. What is your present? The list went on. Pagan, Wiccan, New Age, Buddhist. Again and again, God is not separate from nature and me. Commonalities in their responses, because they had a space in the worldview survey to put other comments down, where we are all one, we're all connected. There's only one universal consciousness. And I asked the question, why are you attending? And they would put down things like friends and connection, to give and receive joy, to have fun, to meet people, to try and forget about the world, to love myself, collective will and intention, to open my mind. One of them wrote down to make a sacrifice to the art gods. And in the camp beside us, I talked to a lady who was a little bit older than myself, and her response was to be with my daughter. When I asked what her religious identification was, it was simply brokenhearted. And this is important because we have to realize these are real people. Real people looking to find answers, looking to find a sense of purpose, meaning, identity. And this is where they run when you reject modernity, when postmodernism doesn't give you the answers anymore, and Christianity has been discarded by the culture. So who attends and participates in evolutionary culture? Well, it's your neighbors. It's your co-workers, your friends, maybe even members of your own family. What's important is that evolutionary culture is just a reflection of what the world already accepts. It is creation turning to itself for spiritual meaning, a container to discover the self in the context of the whole. So let me briefly take you to the mothership. And yes, what you see in the picture is the temporary city of 80,000 people known as Black Rock City. And this is built over a couple of weeks on a flat expanse of nothing desert in the Black Rock, Northern Nevada, and then it is disassembled and done all over again the following year. So Burning Man is a direct extension of the 1960s counterculture. In fact, it takes that early movement to its next level. It's also a stepchild of Silicon Valley. Indeed, Google is a product of the burn experience, as is Second Life, one of the most successful proto-metaverses. Back in 2014, Elon Musk made it clear, Burning Man is Silicon Valley. Burning Man is also the experience of human potential, the chance to discover and feel your higher self. So it takes on a secularized form of spirituality. You don't need a higher power. You can transform and tap into that higher power within yourself. And you do this together. It is also a journey into re-enchantment, the direct experience of that global mythos, to connect into a purpose and a sense of wonder that guides and allows you to feel the chemicalized spiritual flow of oneness. And while it's billed as a party in the desert, it's more. It's much more. It's a crossroads of perennial spirituality, technological visions, a playground for modeling governance, a springboard for new social and relational experiences, especially polyamory. It is immersive art. At a certain level, it influences civic discourse. The U.S. Conference of Mayors has a favorable relationship with Black Rock City. It is psychedelic. It is the externalization of the inner psychedelic experience, and indeed it legitimizes today's neo-psychedelic movement. People search for identity through it. In 2018, while at the temple, one of our camp crew witnessed to a self-professing Christian girl who was in tears. She was attending in the hope of finding identity, what made her who she was. She was being ripped apart by the conflicting pressures of culture on one hand and her faith, and in the strange place she had traveled in the hope of finding some sense of grounding. It was heartbreaking. Our guides prayed with her, publicly, right there at the temple, counseled her, and brought God's word to her. In 2019, I had a long discussion with an official from the European Union who was there on a quest to discover personal meaning and value. Her professional identity and her same-sex identity had left her feeling hollow, and she was hoping this would offer a new vision. And make no mistake, people's identities do form around the burn experience. It's psychologically powerful, and it invokes a sense of spirituality. In fact, that sense of spirituality came through in the 2017 theme. Larry Harvey, the co-founder and by far the most important influencer within the Burning Man culture, said that the moral of our theme, speaking about the 2017 event, Radical Ritual, in fact, was that it doesn't really matter what you believe, it's what you experience. The whole point this year was to convince people that Burning Man is a spiritual movement. It's not a religion, but it's a spiritual movement, and you know it when you see it. So for educational purposes, allow me to show a very short clip and pay attention specifically to what is being said.
It's been called a social experiment, post-apocalyptic training. Some call it home. A temporary city emerges in the desert once each year. No status, no government, no currency. A society focused on the individual. 1 week celebrating humanity, expression, and collaboration. A pilgrimage to disconnect, to look inward, and to explore the self. No inhibitions, no judgment, no rules. By the end, art and buildings will be burnt to ashes. No trace of them will be left. Until next year, where it will be rebuilt again. Into dust storms and scorching heat. The city has been constructed and dismantled over 30 times, entirely by its attendees. A community eager to reconnect, to explore, to build what their imaginations can't conceive. Thousands of strangers come as they are, and share what makes them unique. This experiment isn't about discovering a supreme being. It's about discovering what's supreme in ourselves. A recalibration of the spirit. A reminder to step outside our bubbles. Put down our screens. And rediscover ourselves. To surrender. Let go. And co-create a world together.
During the 2018 broadcast of BMIR, the communal radio station that services Black Rock City, one participant interpreted the Burning Man experience this way. Religion is a set of rules and regulations and guidelines for spiritual principles and practices. What this new religion believes in is the individual. We believe in ourselves as the seemingly impossible becomes attainable. The God or higher power or deity or effective being outside of us is revealed to us in our everyday lives, and we are empowered to follow our passions. So, where are you going, you ask? Well, we're moving forward towards our true potential, the flow, the optimal experience. As a race, each of us finds our passions. Spaceship Earth will not physically land anywhere, but it will land on a new philosophical value that will allow us what our chemical drivers have always been leading us to, a complete cohesion of existence, the coalescing of good and bad into a non-dualistic being. We all recreate and reinvent the God or higher power or deity in our own image as a planet, our own immaculate birth, so to speak. So in one sense, we end up writing the big book in our own lives. So at the center of the city is a large human effigy, which is why it's called Burning Man, because at the end of it, it burns. Now it acts as a symbolic and practical touchstone for the city. So here's the man in 2017, placed in his own pagoda, his own temple, with the theme Radical Ritual. Then in 2018, the man was placed on a large pedestal, and that theme that year was iRobot, asking those questions, can man and machine merge? What is this like? And then in 2019, metamorphosis, can we evolve? Can we blossom? And then at the end of the week, the man is lit on fire, and the community celebrates around the burning of the effigy. There's also a temple, a main temple, and in 2017, this is what the temple looked like. 2018, the temple was dedicated to the cosmic Gaia. It was a temple of Galaxia. And then here is a picture of the 2019 temple. And the temple is unique. It's a blank slate. It starts off as an empty canvas. And then over the course of the week, people scribble and scroll messages. They will leave pictures of loved ones, bring urns of the ashes of those friends and family members who've passed away. They'll hang up wedding dresses. It becomes a place of mourning. It is a heartbreak. And then at the end of the week, it burns as well. Now, the artwork itself at Burning Man often blurs the lines between imagination and what is possible. It is something that compels participants to interact, to find inspiration, ask questions, including questions of faith and tradition. And while mockery and play is very much a part of the culture, there is a special mockery, a critical mockery of Christianity. No surprise. I saw one example of this mockery in a way that absolutely aligned with the concepts of re-enchantment. Back in 2017, I attended Reverend Billy's famous Sunday sermon. Now, Reverend Billy is a well-known personality within the burn culture. And so at Center Camp, he had this sermon. And this is what he told us. He says, "We have fired the patriarchal God who claims to know everything. Science doesn't know everything. So where do we turn? We turn to ourselves. We turn to the sacred earth. The earth sustains and embraces us. Trust the earth, even in our death." Everybody say a big earthalluja. And it's a place also where futures are being envisioned. I went to a workshop in 2018 on the connection between psychedelics, spirituality, and technology. And the individual broke down what the new world would look like in four building blocks. And he did this over the course of roughly 2 hours. This is just snapshots of his four main points. Spirituality: we will enter an era of psychedelic, shamanistic, mystical, Eastern spirituality. Out with that old worldview and in with this new worldview. We're developing a social ethos, and that is being experimented and built right here in real time at Burning Man. We also need to enter a new building block of economics and governance, and cryptocurrencies specifically will be tied into new forms of social contract. How then will we enable and ensure that people will operate with values and behaviors aligned to block one and block two? How will this happen? Well, we will manage it through artificial intelligence and your purchasing habits. So what is our response? It's to engage as ambassadors for Christ. But what does this mean? I think one of the best early church examples, and we need an early church example, of being an ambassador is Paul at Athens in the book of Acts in chapter 17. Here, Paul is visiting what is a pagan city, and he has surveyed its spiritual landscape. There are some believers in the true God, yes, but the primary worldview is a pagan orientation. Looking at the many shrines and temples to pagan deities, he sees a monument with an inscription to the unknown God. Then he's taken to the council of the Areopagus, a legal body of judges, a special council charged with examining new religious claims. And they were really the city's spiritual gatekeepers. Now, these eminent judges met on a hill adjacent to the Acropolis, the spiritual hub of the city, a place that housed a collection of prominent temples to pagan gods and goddesses. And that, in part, is the context. Paul, standing before the city judges, being questioned under the shadow of the most important pagan temples, Paul must give an account. Intimidating? Absolutely. So Paul then leverages what he has observed. Using the monument to the unknown God as a launching pad, he then tells them that the one that they don't know is the Creator, specifically Lord of heaven and earth, who doesn't reside in temples and isn't fashioned by art. This God rather gives life and breath to all people and even establishes the boundaries of mankind. Paul then goes on to reference their own philosophers, and to make his argument, he quotes from the hymn of Zeus. Paul has entered their world and understands their world. He spoke of repentance, of how God will judge everyone through the righteousness of Jesus Christ, proving this by raising Jesus from the dead. Of course, some of the council mocked what he had to say, others wished to hear more, and some who were listening came to Christ. Paul, however, was just the messenger. He was an ambassador, a truth teller. And I believe that this is an important model for how to engage in our Roman I culture. We have to understand the situation. We have to recognize a common point of entry. Then we present the distinct character of the true God, that he is different from creation. We lay out the truth of our fallen human nature and the answer that comes through Jesus Christ alone. This is a truth trajectory that I think we must follow. So at the Parliament of the World's Religion, there are a handful of believers who do just that. And I've been fortunate to connect with them as they move among the people, going from booth to booth, talking and sharing about Jesus Christ in the most pluralist setting in the world. And at Burning Man, I have the opportunity to be with a group of dedicated believers who will rally around our banner, taken out of Acts 17, the camp of the unknown God. Each year that we have set up at the burn, we have had a range of conversations, some incredible conversations, some hard and difficult and wonderful conversations. One special conversation that comes to mind, and there are a few, is back in 2017 when a young Russian artist walked by our camp and blurted out, "Who is this unknown God?" And in our time together, he clearly aligned with the Oneness position, for he was an esoteric artist, his spirituality connected to the energy of the universe, and it framed his artwork and his identity. So then using the two-ism versus one-ism model, yes, that's exactly what happened, we talked about God as distinct and the exclusive claim of Jesus Christ as the author of life who defeated death, and he listened. But the conversation had to move to something personal. So at one point I asked him, "Are you saying that your value is equal to your art?" Remember, he was an artist. "No, of course not," he responded. "I'm of more value than my art." Then emotion to the sky and the mountains around us, the expanse that was evident before us. And there's a stark beauty in this part of the world, in this incredible desert. And God is the ultimate artist, I said. And then rhetorically asked, "Are you telling me that the artist is the same as his artwork?" And a knowing smile came across his face, and he responded by affirming that indeed the artist is higher than his art. Yes, God had to be different, True spirituality, I explained to him, has to be grounded in someone who is unchangeable and positioned higher than his creation. And the Russian artist nodded in agreement. This is temporary, he said to me. Yeah, it's so temporary that we burn the man. I want to conclude with the words of Francis Schaeffer. It is my hope that this generation may turn from that greatest of wickedness, the placing of any created thing in the place of the Creator, and that this generation may get its feet out of the paths of death and may live. Listen, if you'd like to know more about the trends of our age, the historical context, and its modern manifestations, so that you're better informed to be an ambassador, then check out Game of Gods, The Temple of Man in the Age of Reenchantment. Now, the book covers issues such as the shift into and beyond postmodernism, the rise of paganism, the cult of world order, the spiritual politics of interfaithism, how transhumanism is a counter-salvation movement, and the influence and scope of transformational culture. And then as a free service to you, I have a number of articles and reports of interest on my website, forcingchange.org. From 2007 until 2015, I produced a monthly intelligence publication, as I explained in the beginning of this talk, and it touched on the religious, political, and cultural forces of change. So you can go there and, for free, download all the back issues if you would like. So go to gameofgods.ca to learn more about my book, and certainly sign up and utilize the resources at forcingchange.org. God bless. Thank you.